Hello, marine biology students. In this video, we're going to talk about energy flow and nutrient cycles within ecosystems. So energy flows through an ecosystem, and we call this flow of energy the trophic structure. It is driven by primary producers. These are going to be the organisms that generate food, usually from some external energy source, whether it's from a light source or a chemical source. The primary producers are the autotrophs that make the food. And then there will often be one to many levels of consumers. These are going to be heterotrophs that feed on food that was made by the primary producers. And they can either feed directly on the primary producers, or they can feed on animals that feed on the primary producers. And there can be many steps in a food web. On average, only about 10% of the energy is transferred to the next level of the food chain. We call this the pyramid of energy. This means the total amount of energy made by the primary producers, of that energy, only about 10% of it is going to be represented within the bodies and biomass of those first level consumers. And as those first level consumers are consumed by second level consumers, only 10% of that first level consumer is going to be represented as biomass or energy in that second level. The energy pyramid represents each trophic level by a volume directly proportional. To the energy stored in new tissue per unit time. Energy pyramids can never be inverted, meaning narrow at the base and broad at the top, because of the laws of thermodynamics. It would be impossible for there to be more energy in a second level of an energy pyramid than in the first. So, for example, if phytoplankton generate 10 million calories of primary production, and the krill, which feed directly on the phytoplankton, produce 1 million calories, then whales are only going to have 100,000 calories in their biomass, again, for every 10 million calories made by the phytoplankton. So this is our energy pyramid. Now, baleen whales, they are only second level consumers. But as we can see, there are third, fourth, fifth, even sixth level consumers in this Antarctic food web, meaning that the amount of energy stored in each killer whale took an extremely large amount of energy in the previous levels in order to be developed. Now, we can see energy levels coming from several different areas, but killer whales are the apex predator of an Antarctic food web, followed closely by leopard seals and Weddell seals. Primary production is the organic matter that is left over after the primary producers have met their own needs. And this makes up the base of that trophic pyramid. So the diatoms, which are the primary producers in that Antarctic food web, they are performing photosynthesis. However, they are also using photosynthetic product for their own growth and development and reproduction. They are producing oxygen as a result of their photosynthesis, but they are also using oxygen as a result of their own respiration. So primary production really just is the excess material after the primary producers meet their own needs. Another term to be aware of is the standing stock. The standing stock is the total amount of phytoplankton, the main primary producers in the water. And so it's the standing stock, which we use to make measurements about photosynthesis that's happening, but also the consumption of photosynthetic product necessary for those primary producers to still be present. In a marine system, primary productivity is generally measured as a 1 meter water column, and all of the photosynthesis happening in that column, minus the respiration happening by those primary producers, that is the primary productivity of that column. Measures of primary productivity can be done by taking a water sample and storing it either in a chamber that is transparent to sunlight versus a chamber that is opaque or dark. That dark chamber is going to tell us how much oxygen is being used by respiration and how much of that organic matter is being used and broken down by those diatoms. So we can compare those two to see what the net production of oxygen is from the photosynthesis. In ecosystems, we often talk about nutrient cycles, and some of these major nutrients include things like carbon or nitrogen and phosphorus. Carbon is used by primary producers to manufacture organic molecules, and they do this through a process called photosynthesis. These initial photosynthetic products are then going to be converted into more complex carbon compounds, either by the primary producers themselves or also consumers of these primary producers. Carbon dioxide is eventually released from all organisms through respiration and decomposition. And so when we look at the carbon cycle, the source of carbon for these primary producers is going to be the carbon dioxide gas that's dissolved in the seawater. This carbon dioxide is going to be obtained both through the atmosphere, but also from other internal sources. As detritus and dissolved organic matter decompose, they contribute to the dissolved CO2. As fish feed on both the primary producers and on the detritus and dissolved organic matter, they are going to contribute dissolved carbon dioxide through their respiration. Primary producers are mostly a sink for this carbon dioxide in that they take more in than they give off from respiration. However, their death and excretion and consumption by other organisms will end up taking that and returning it into the water column. We'll also see that organic matter and carbon will be deposited to the sea floor in the form of sediments, but that those sediments can also dissolve, resulting in some of that carbon dioxide being returned back into the water column. So as you can see with this carbon cycle, it can be quite intricate with many different sources and sinks for carbon. Nitrogen and phosphorus will be similar. Nitrogen and phosphorus are also required for primary production and must be cycled through the ecosystem. Both are important limiting factors. For primary producers in many marine ecosystems. The main source of dissolved nitrogen gas within the water column is from the atmosphere, yet nitrogen gas is not accessible to most organisms, and so there can be nitrogen-fixing bacteria and organisms in the water that allow for that atmospheric nitrogen to go in a form that can be usable, such as nitrates, nitrites, and ammonia. However, we'll also see inputs from rivers, just dust and other lithogenous sediments coming in from the continents, and then through the organisms living within this ecosystem as well. Again, primary producers will primarily be absorbing nitrogen and nitrites and ammonia. They are going to be a sink for this, although some will be released by excretion. Conversely, the consumers are mostly going to be contributing in the form of excretion, although they might absorb some themselves. And detritus and dissolved organic matter, as it decomposes, will also contribute to the dissolved nitrogen. The phosphate cycle will be similar in that most of the phosphate is coming from lithogenous or atmospheric sources. So either coming in through rivers or just simply particulate matter coming down from the atmosphere. And this dissolved phosphate is essential for primary producers, and it also will be released by excretion and decomposition. However, precipitation or moraine snow, the falling of organic matter down from the water column to the ocean floor, can take with it phosphate, and in that way it is removed from the system. The last topic for this particular portion of the lecture has to do with organismal lifestyles in their ecosystems. There are three major lifestyles of marine organisms. There are those of the benthos. Which are going to be associated with the sea floor. They might be attached or they might move around on the bottom, but they are going to limit their activity to the ocean floor, that interface. This is in contrast to the pelagic organisms, which live within the water column themselves. Of these pelagic organisms, some of them are not going to be especially strong swimmers. They're simply going to move with current, and we call these the plankton. This can include both phytoplankton and zooplankton, and there can be microplankton, but also macroplankton. Conversely, the strongly swimming organisms are known as the nekton. When looking at the different regions of the oceans and the different water layers that we're going to be talking about through these weeks, the intertidal is the zone between high tide and low tide, a region that will be exposed at least once, but sometimes twice a day in most marine environments. Then we have the neritic waters, which are part of the pelagic system. They are considered near shore, and they are on top of the continental shelf up until the shelf break. From the shelf break onward, we have the oceanic region of the pelagic zone, and there are several different layers of that oceanic region. The epipelagic is the surface of the oceanic region, and this is where light can still penetrate, and so photosynthesis will be the primary form of primary production. In the mesopelagic, light is reduced, and organisms can still see light, but photosynthesis will be far less efficient. In the bathypelagic and abyssopelagic, these are going to be oceanic regions which have no light at all, except for that's caused by the organisms living in those areas. And a variety of very strange and interesting sea creatures live in the bathypelagic and abyssopelagic. We'll be talking about all of these environments in this next section of the course. In most of these, we are going to see both benthic organisms and also pelagic organisms. So the benthos So when we're talking about organisms that are associated with the bottom, when the intertidal zone, any permanent residents would have to be benthic, because for part of the time, water simply isn't present. And this is the region that is exposed between high tide and low tide. In the subtidal zone, this is going to be the region below the low tide level, all the way to the edge of the continental shelf. It will always be submerged, and the benthic organisms here still likely are exposed to light during the day. But then in the deep sea, in the bithyl and abyssal and hadal zones, this is going to be beyond the shelf break, and the benthic organisms here likely will not include primary producers, or at least not photosynthetic producers. The primary producers would have to have other means of generating energy. For the pelagic organisms, the epipelagic zone is going to be the surface waters. This will be from the surface to about 100 to 200 meters. There will be plenty of sunlight available to support photosynthesis, as the main means of primary production. The mesopelagic. Is the zone that extends from lower limits of the epipelagic to about 1,000 meters. There is reduced light, but some light can still be seen, just not enough for photosynthesis. And then in the bathypelagic, abyssopelagic, and hadropelagic zones, these are deep sea zones where light does not penetrate, but that free-swimming organisms can still be found. And that completes our discussion of energy flow and nutrient cycles. Now, have you ever thought that the annual temperature fluctuation in southern Nevada was pretty extreme? Well, let me introduce you to the intertidal. See you in the next video.